Hi everybody, Ian Bremmer here, and today we have something we have never done before. We're updating our top risks in the middle of the year. You know, we come out with these every year, right first Monday in January. I've been doing it since the start of the firm, but with the extraordinary impact of the coronavirus crisis, we thought it was worth going back, taking a look at what we wrote in January and updating the entire report. I think the importance here is that the level of sudden shock that the coronavirus plays in an economic environment that's fairly strong but was softening, but in a political environment that's extremely soft, dysfunctional, and uncoordinated, actually exacerbates a number of the risks that we were talking about. Three in particular, right at the top, are the ones that I would be most concerned about. One having to do with the US directly, and two having to do with global dynamics and US-China. To take them in turn, the United States, we said our top risk this year for the first time in history was a domestic US risk. It was called rigged and US elections. Since we wrote that risk, the coronavirus means that the level of impact of the global economy on Trump's reelection is gonna be significant. He looked like a favorite. Most incumbents are, even though Trump was comparatively unpopular, because the markets were doing so well, unemployment very low, and growth was reasonably robust under the first 3+ years of the Trump administration. That is clearly no longer the case. Massive shock to the markets. Deep recession coming in the United States and globally. Also, a feeling of Trump having mishandled the coronavirus. Certainly made strong moves at the beginning in closing off borders with China, but otherwise domestically late to the game, ineffective healthcare system. That's been the case for a long time, but as you know, irrespective of who is at fault for all this, whatever comes when you're president, if you're in an economic boom cycle, you get a benefit. If you're in an economic bust cycle, it really hurts you. This is really gonna hurt Trump. So come November, the most important issue everyone's talking about is the response to the coronavirus and the level of impact. That means that Trump is going to feel increasingly defensive, and the likelihood that he's willing to take extra legal means to try to ensure the election is swung in his direction is going up. Let's also keep in mind that the election cycle itself is going to be disrupted by coronavirus. We already have several states that have delayed their primaries on the back of the inability of people to safely get to their places to be polled. That's also gonna be true over the course of the real election. We're not gonna be done with this, I don't believe, when we get to November. There's still gonna be issues. We won't have a vaccine yet, which means probably you get lower levels of turnout. Obviously means that it's gonna be disruptive for the election itself. And if you're moving to new types of balloting, like everyone's vote by mail, you're putting that in place from scratch, and the potential for that to be put in ways that are seen as advantaging the side that makes the rules, state by state, key governors, swing states, more red, less blue, but nonetheless plays out in both sides, gonna be seen as delegitimized. Add to that the fact that Biden is gonna be the nominee, and he's the guy that Trump already was trying to go after in terms of launching investigations from Ukraine. You'll see more of that going on. Ability of the Americans' willingness to defend against external intervention, also low. So the likelihood that these elections are seen as rigged is going up. Also, the timing of that concern is likely to be driven forward given the politicization around the response to the coronavirus crisis. Okay, the two other big ones that are getting significantly more challenging as risks both have to do with China. One is the great decoupling of the global economy, change in trajectory of globalization was happening primarily around technology, now is occurring more deeply around the manufacturing sectors and service sectors, in part because just in time, supply chain turns out to be not very effective when you have a massive shock. You want just in case supply chain, which means you want to be closer to your own customers. So China takes a hit there, there's decoupling. But also the fact that we're heading into a greater fight between the US and China also leads to a greater level of decoupling because it's going to be patriotic for American companies when you have unemployment spiking to come and have more jobs in the United States. Trump will play that card. CEOs will play that card. So there's going to be a more significant exodus from Chinese production into other countries around the world, localization, regionalization, not just about the technology fight between Huawei and the Americans and the Europeans on 5G, but much more broadly, deeply into the economy. Final point, the US-China relationship, risk number three, that's also a very significant increase in global risk. Why? Because the Chinese are the ones that originally covered up the crisis. And that led to an explosion of cases in China and outside. The Americans are politicizing that, referring to it as the China virus, as the Wuhan virus. Meanwhile, the Chinese are taking advantage of the fact that the Americans are acting more unilaterally, that the Europeans don't really trust them on a lot of accounts. They're the ones that came out of the crisis more quickly, dramatically different than we saw in 2008 following the great global recession. And as a consequence, they're traveling all over the world, including with American allies, the Italians, the Spaniards, East Europeans, the Middle East, and saying, you can trust China, you can't trust those Americans. That's playing out in their favor. It's going to get politicized as the Chinese are looking for stronger patriotism, given much softer economic growth numbers, and the Americans are more willing to blame the Chinese, especially given the upcoming elections. So US-China relations are likely to get significantly worse. Are there any places that look more promising in this environment? Well, one thing I would say is our risks about multinational corporations feeling populist backlash. In this environment, the CEOs are going to step up and be a part of the solution. You saw that with the markets picking up last week as all the CEOs were up there with President Trump on the stage saying, here's what we can do to respond, to get infrastructure moving, information moving on coronavirus. And the tech lash against the companies like Google and Facebook and Microsoft, so much less of that when everyone is moving towards buying virtually, connecting virtually, and those systems are actually working pretty well, knock on wood, so far for the Americans and for citizens around the world. So the likelihood that you're gonna see strong populism to squeeze those corporations is going down. Finally, one that is a reduced risk, though you may not be happy about it, depending on who's listening here, is on climate. The likelihood that climate was getting more politicized and pushing both for effective and also ineffective responses to climate in terms of governance, in terms of grassroots society. I mean, back at Davos this year, you remember Greta Thunberg. I mean, everyone was talking about climate. That was before Wuhan. Not many people talking about climate right now. First of all, not because the global economy is contracting. So as a consequence, this year, you're going to get a lot of reduction in terms of carbon coming in the atmosphere, not because of individual action, but actually because we've got a major recession on our hands. But also, when people are worried about their safety, about healthcare, about their families, they're paying less attention to issues like what's happening to our ice caps and what's happening in 10 and 20 and 30 years down the road. It's gotten much more immediate. So short term, much less disruption coming from movement on climate. Long term, of course, that's another concern we're going to have as to how we respond to some of the big global challenges that are out there. If you want to watch this whole thing, you can look at our new Top Risk Update report. It's on eurasiagroup.net. Check it out on the homepage. We'll also be all over the media talking about this, of course, and I'll see you all very soon.